Listening Library presents Terminal, a Virals novel by Kathy Reichs and Brendan Reichs. Read for you by Cristin Milioti. Attention, Director Walsh, eyes only. File status, top secret, level 5. Case number 34687, aka Phoenix Inquiry. File type, surveillance report. Conversation recorded without the subject's knowledge under the authority of Information Containment Protocol 12.C, ICP 12.C-1.1. Date, April 8, 2014. Subjects, Brennan, Victoria G., VB. Clayborne, Chance A., CC. Principal Investigating Agents, J. Saltman, B. Rogers. Recording Agents, J. Saltman, B. Rogers. Recording location, 74 B Street, Charleston, South Carolina. Headquarters, Candela Pharmaceuticals, Inc. Additional notes. Investigating agents believe the Phoenix Inquiry should be elevated to active mission status, requesting operational resources and field personnel. Time, 10:34 a.m. VB.
When did you learn how to flare, Chance?
CC.
Over the last few days, though Lern is fairly generous, I have almost no idea how it works. My powers can snap on without warning or fizzle in seconds.
VB.
Still, that's incredible. It took me weeks to gain even that much control.
Pause.
How'd this happen? How'd you suddenly become viral?
CC.
I was careless. Didn't take proper precautions in the lab. Then, last week, I got terribly sick. Could barely function. Strange things started happening to my body. Unnerving side effects you won't find on WebMD. By that point, I no longer had any illusions about the cause.
VB.
The weird sensation I've been experiencing lately. An odd kinetic force, like my mind is connecting to things around me. It spikes around you. Because of you, I'm sure of it now. How can that be?
CC.
Don't ask me, I'm new to the species, remember?
Pause.
Maybe it involves whatever sets you apart from normal people. Sets us apart, I should say now. Perhaps your unconscious mind innately recognizes the presence of another viral.
VB.
That can't be it. I've had this feeling for months now, off and on, since right after the hurricane. I noticed it at least a half dozen times before last week.
CC.
Yeah, about that.
Pause. VB.
Yes?
CC.
Well, you know I've been following you.
Pause.
But you probably don't know for how long.
VB.
What? For months?
Pause.
Months? Seriously? Are you saying you were in Charlotte after the storm?
CC.
Had to go somewhere.
VB.
What about Morris Island?
CC.
I visited a few times, unannounced.
VB.
Even to our private retreat?
CC.
You mean that hill bunker?
Laughter.
Nice place. I love the decor. How'd you get all that stuff in there?
VB.
Jesus.
Pause.
How'd you find it? Because of me?
CC.
I don't pretend to understand any of this. But sometimes, if I concentrate really hard, I can pinpoint exactly where you are. I sense your presence. Perhaps in the same way you detected mine. I can't explain it either.
VB.
That's...
CC.
Also, I'm fairly certain I've been infected for a while. Months, most likely. Probably since the first few days of the brimstone experiment. What you just said, that you've been sensing my presence for some time, all but confirms it.
VB.
How is that possible? How could you carry a supervirus that long and not change?
CC.
I have a guess. The parvovirus strain used in Brimstone was slightly different from the one that infected you. Better, we thought, though we obviously had no idea what we were doing. I think our pathogen has a longer incubation period, which would explain the course of my infection. This viral deviation must have caused other differences, too.
VB, your eyes glow red. Chance, not golden. Why? CC, pause.
I don't know. I wish I did. I'm just glad I stopped puking all day.
VB, how do you feel now? CC,
great. My fever broke yesterday. The chills and sweats are finally gone. I can actually stand without feeling dizzy. But I have no idea what's happened to my body.
VB, yesterday? Pause. Interesting. CC,
why?
VB, because our flares were a mess last week. Erratic, unstable, mine backfired more than once. We couldn't understand why. But it seems like the trouble occurred during your worst symptoms. CC,
you think my sickness was somehow related?
VB, I don't know, but our powers stabilized at the same time you recovered. CC,
could be a coincidence.
VB, maybe. Pause. Or maybe your transformation was disrupting whatever shared mind space virals inhabit. We don't really know how any of this works either. Perhaps your evolution created a ripple in the telepathic framework of our pack. That makes as much sense as anything. CC.
Our pack? Does that mean I'm one of you?
VB. I don't know. That's not up to me alone. It might not even be something we can choose. CC.
Well, I hope we can choose, Tory. I hope your friends will accept me.
VB. I'll try to convince them. I promise that much. CC.
Good, because I...
Long pause. Muffled noise. VB. Chance? CC.
I haven't told you everything yet.
Pause. VB. Oh my God. Pause. The night on the beach. CC.
I was wondering when you'd remember.
VB. When I was attacked on Morris Island, afterward I saw 3 sets of red eyes in the dunes. 3, Chance. CC.
Yes. I'm afraid you did.
End transcript. Prologue. 5 weeks later. The Trinity peered down from atop a church tower. They sat stone still, watching the sleek black skyscraper across the street. Brilliant white lettering along its apex labeled it the worldwide headquarters of Candela Pharmaceuticals. The 4 had entered hours ago. The sun had set, yet they remained inside. Night blanketed the city, cloaking the figures in darkness. A low growl floated on the wind. The largest turned blood-red eyes on 2 companions. A jerk of the head motioned them to follow. They were ready, determined. But it would have to be another day. As one, the trio crept across a narrow ledge, ignoring heart-stopping drops to either side, and vaulted gracefully onto a lower roof. Moving like ghosts, they leaped to a willow tree in the yard below, then dropped into a small cemetery. The smallest hissed softly. The largest grunted in agreement. Soon. The 4 lived on a remote island. The Trinity had observed their alpha there once before. She and her mixed blood beast. Rivals. A second growl escaped, louder than the first. Soon. With preternatural grace, the figures melted into the shadowy field of tombstones. 3 haunting calls echoed down the streets of Charleston. Soon. Part 1. Challenge. Chapter 1.
My adversary charged at full speed, intent on running me down. Not this time. I nudged the ball left, deftly sidestepping the girl's clumsy challenge. Keeping my head up, I spotted Ella 20 yards ahead, streaking for the corner. The field opened like a book, and for once...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.